Have your groovy pants on. You're still feeling it in your soul.
Groovy pants. That's another name for corduroys, right?
It sounds about right.
Indeed.
Here we are with the dad jokes. Brent, I don't have Tim's feed, and I know we were talking about my internet being mediocre, so I'm just going to do a quick refresh here while we dance.
Sure.
And if you want to just go ahead and interact and get us started, and then I'll come back in as soon as I got a chance to.
Get the tech in order. Go for it. Well, good morning, everybody. Our guest this morning is the wonderful and amazing Tim Slade. How are you, sir?
Morning. I'm good. How are you?
Doing great. Especially now after, what am I, on my third cup of coffee?
Third? Oh, wow.
Makes me feel good.
Yeah.
And a little bit of music to go. Hey, everybody in the chat. Thanks for joining us. Wow, look at all of you from all over the globe. Fantastic, and the weather looks nice everywhere. I don't see any bad weather. Let's see, did I miss any bad weather?
Well, even Seattle is sunny today, so I think that's a sign.
That's a good day.
Yeah. I think so.
That is a sign.
If it's sunny in Seattle, it can't be bad anywhere, right?
Indeed.
That's a thing, right? Oh, it's rainy in Ann Arbor. Okay, well.
Uh-oh.
We do our best, guys. We put the weather orders in early every week. For Wednesdays, but you know, head office never really listens to us all the time. They've got their own priorities.
Yeah. They do.
Good morning, everybody. We have Tim Slade with us. Tim's been with us a couple of times in the past. Always great conversations. But for the folks who haven't met you before this time, Tim, give us a little introduction to yourself. Tell us a little bit about yourself so folks know who you are and where you're coming from.
Yeah, so I'm here in Phoenix, where Brent is, and I work as a freelance e-learning designer, instructional designer. I've been doing that for a little over 10 years now, and then running my own business as a side gig since 2012, and then I finally went full-time on my own back in 2019. And when I'm not working with clients doing custom e-learning development, I try and work to mentor, coach, help other new e-learning designers and instructional designers become better e-learning designers and instructional designers.
Very cool.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Very cool. And Patty's mentioning in the chat already that she's got your latest book sitting on her desk right
now. Oh,
here.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that, Patty.
Very cool. That's awesome.
Good. And we'll make sure that we, make sure we'll get a link into the chat to the book. Today we're talking about creating engaging e-learning through visual design. Which is a thing, a topic, an area, a place where, well, I was going to say, is it your happy place, Tim? But it's definitely a focus place. I guess if it was your, when you do it, it's probably a happy place. But for other people, it's probably you want to bring them to the happy place, maybe.
Yeah, you know, visual design is one of those things I think universally a lot of people in our industry struggle with. And I think part of that's because, you know, when you fall into e-learning or instructional design or however, whatever you define yourself as, nobody tells you that, you know, part of your job is being a visual designer. And I find that it's something that a lot of people struggle with for one reason or another. And for me personally, you know, I don't know, I've always enjoyed the creative aspects of, you know, e-learning development, e-learning design. And it's something that I was not good at originally when I first started. I was really bad at it. And I've always really had a passion for that intersection between creating really good interactive content and then making it as visually pleasing as possible. And so it kind of became my niche in terms of what I do when I'm, you know, developing e-learning content.
Tell us the story. I love this story. I don't know why, but tell us the story of how you got into learning and development and training.
Yeah. Oh gosh, I feel like I tell this story all the time, but it resonates with people, so I'm happy to tell it. You know, for those of you who don't know me, I don't have a background in learning or instructional design or anything like that. I used to work in retail loss prevention, catching shoplifters. And I have a degree in criminal justice, and I did that, you know, for almost 8 years. And Brent, I worked at Superstition Springs Mall. I worked at the Fiesta Mall catching shoplifters, the Chandler Fashion Center. I mean, yeah, some of those malls are pretty rough. I loved catching shoplifters. I was really good at catching shoplifters, and I still have an eye for it. I can be in a store and I can tell when somebody's shoplifting. One day my boss came along and he said, "Hey, you know, you're really good at catching shoplifters. There's a training coordinator position open in the corporate offices in Wisconsin." I was working at Kohl's department stores. I was 23 at the time. And he said, "Hey, you should go apply for this job, you know, train others how to catch shoplifters." And I thought, cool, this will advance my loss prevention career. I'll become the corporate loss prevention guy. So I applied and I somehow got the job, even though I had no idea what, you know, instructional design was or training was. I just was really good at catching shoplifters. And I moved to Wisconsin. You know, I had a really crappy Ford Focus, and I packed all my stuff into that Ford Focus with my cat and drove across country. And that was, you know, that was in 2009. And, you know, I was exposed to e-learning development and graphic design and instructional design. And, you know, I think what I went through during that first year, which is what I think a lot of people go through when they first get thrown into this industry, is that career identity crisis where you're like, well, I thought I was a loss prevention person, but I'm really now an e-learning person, and you don't know which way you want to go. And so I decided to go with e-learning, and, you know, that was 10 years ago, and the rest is history.
It's kind of, a microcosm in a sense for how so many people end up, right? You were an expert in something, you had the knowledge, and they wanted you to share it. So you got shifted horizontally into this career.
Yeah.
As opposed to saying, that's a career that I'd like to do, and I'm going to learn about it, get trained or whatever in it, and then it'll be my career. It's such a common-ish story, and yet not many people, I think, come from loss prevention. Most people are subject matter experts in a technical field or something.
You'd be educators.
Teachers are a big one right now. You'd be amazed at how many people I've met who are like, "Oh, I used to catch shoplifters too," and that blows my mind. You know, the interesting thing about it, though, is you're right. It is this. So many people have that same kind of story, but when you're in it, like in that moment, when you realize you've shifted, you feel like you're totally alone. Like you feel like, gosh, I got plucked out of obscurity and I'm around all these like learning people who are really astute in learning theory. But what you don't realize at the time is that you're actually part of the majority, and those people who do have backgrounds are actually the minority. And so you have this really bad, like, this is so true in our industry, is this really, really deep sense of imposter syndrome. And I still struggle with it. Like I still, every time I do a talk on e-learning or my past, I always say, like, I don't consider myself a learning professional at heart. I was a loss prevention person who just happened to be, you know, good at teaching people, you know, what I was good at the time. So,
and your visual design skills are impeccable. They're awesome.
Oh, thank you.
I remember the first time you sent me the PDF of your book. Everybody sends me a PDF of their book and asks if I'll review it. Well, I don't know if everybody does, but I get a lot of them. Let's just put it that way. And I can remember, you know, I normally just don't even think about it. I'm just like, yeah, send it my way. But I remember opening yours up specifically out of the email. And when it popped up, I was like, oh my, somebody gets it. Somebody gets the whole design thing. I was super psyched. I'm like, you got your landscape instead of portrait, right? And the whole thing. And it's simple. It's very clean design and layout. And it's super cool. You did a fantastic job with that.
Thank you. Funny story about that. When I wrote the first edition of the book, I even did this with the second edition, which I changed the layout a little bit, and I made it in color and all this great stuff. But when I first started writing the book, I did some searching on Amazon. I was going to say research, but I was really just Googling.
That's research. Legit. Yeah. Come on. Oh, yeah.
I went on Amazon and I Googled, you know, e-learning and instructional design books. And all of the books that are out there or at the time were out there were just really ugly. Like there was, you know, I'm not going to name names and I don't know who wrote this book. There was a book on instructional design that had literally, it was a picture of a beach on like a really cloudy, crappy looking day with like some seagulls walking on it. And I was like, this, what is that? That has nothing to do. So what I did instead is I did the opposite of what a lot of people do. I actually designed the cover and the interior layout before I even wrote a single word. And what that allowed me to do was to be really intentional about how the design of the book and the content married together. And for me, because I love visual design, it gave me the motivation and excitement to like write the whole book by envisioning what the final design would look like. So, and that's what I did with the second edition too.
So, and the reason why I bring that up, and because you had mentioned that to me before, mm-hmm. and I know sometimes this can be kind of a bone of contention amongst designers and what, yeah. What comes first, right? The tech or the content, the tech or the content kind of thing. And I do the same thing that you do most of the time. I frame out a bunch of designs first and then start figuring out how the content that I have is going to fit in there. Sometimes the designs have to flex because of the content or for whatever reason. But I like taking that approach too. And so we've been talking a lot about this as far as templates. And a lot of people are like, oh, no, don't use templates. You have to design from scratch. And it has to be, you know, because of the thing, you know, because of the content. But it's nice to have that framework, that design constriction to be able to do that. And so do you make that a part of your teaching? Do you help people understand that a little bit better?
Yeah, well, so the way I think of it is the big mistake a lot of people do is they compartmentalize the content design, meaning the flow of the content, the words on the screen or the words in the audio narration or the learning object, all the content, they think of it separately from the design, the visual design. And they go, okay, I'll work on the content, then I'll make it look pretty later. And then they go try to make it look pretty. And then they realize, gosh, I have all these bullet points and I don't know how I'm going to communicate this text. So what I do is I think the visual design and the presentation of your content, especially in an e-learning format, is so critical to the effectiveness of your actual, the words you put on the screen or the content you're trying to present. And so I try to design them at the same time because they have to marry together. And to your point about templates, you know, I used to love templates, and then I went through a period where I hated templates. And what I realized, what I hate about templates, and I it's not the act of using a template that's wrong. It's how people use templates. When you use a template, like you get a PowerPoint template and it has a beautiful header and a beautiful footer, but this big white space in the middle, people who use templates, when they use them poorly, they just fill that white space with all their bullet points thinking, oh, this template's going to make my content look pretty. Well, it's really not about making it look pretty. It's about how do you visually communicate your content on that slide using that template. So does that make sense?
We're talking about, you know, the, you know, visual versus, you know, content first or whatever, really, even those of us who go down the content avenue first, you already know at least somewhat where the content's going. So that's already shaping the kind of content you're putting together. I'm writing a blog post. This is the thing I'm doing a community article and I want these activities to be embedded in it. Oh, it's an e-learning course. I know that. So I'm going to have multiple pages. So I got to write. Yep. So you are already forming your content, even the gathering, you know, and the structuring of it, you're already forming that to something that's an end design. It's just that aspects of that end design may not be entirely, you know, pinned down. So the context is already informing, you know, how you're shaping the content too. So, and sometimes restrictions are actually a valuable tool. Being kept within a box, saves time, but also maybe forces you to do something, you know, that's very effective, as opposed to sky's the limit. Let's go hog wild and end up way off track.
Well, one of the things I always tell people, you know, when I'm storyboarding a slide that's going to have animations and audio narration, like an explainer screen, if you will, One of the things I always tell people is like, never storyboard anything you can't visually communicate. And so what you have to do is like, if you're storyboarding something that's going to be animated, every sentence, every word, every line, every paragraph, you have to be thinking, how am I going to represent this on the screen? And if you can't figure, if you can't envision it in your mind's eye, usually that's an indicator that you need to rework that content till you can figure out how it's going to be communicated. Because it's, you're not just putting words on the screen. You shouldn't be, unless you're creating a text-based course. If you're creating a multimedia experience, you have to think about, how am I going to translate that visually on the screen? Because, you know, your audio narration is one thing. How you represent that audio narration is a totally separate thing. So that's, I think that's, that, that really encapsulates a lot of the struggles I think people have, is thinking visually as they're creating their content.
Yeah. And so many of us are just not trained. I mean, we're immersed in visual. We have the big screen, you know, in front of us in the evening. We've got the small screen in front of us all day. We've got the TikToks going by. We've got the memes, you know, so we're immersed in visual communication. But it's the learning to think in that way, to be able to take advantage of that successfully, that is a gap for so many of us.
Yeah, it has to be a very intentional thing. And it's a muscle you have to exercise and practice. And it's not something like, I wasn't born with that ability. It took a lot of time and a lot of intention before it became a natural part of what I do. So for those who are struggling with that, you just have to make an, you have to make a concerted effort to think visually, despite your gut instinct telling you not to.
Yeah, I was just going to say, so how would we tell people, or how do you tell people in your workshops and in your academy that you run and everything? How do you help people get over that? Because a lot of times it's all in their head too, right?
Yeah.
It's like this negativity, like, I'm not creative. Everybody somehow gets it beaten out of them as they're growing up. And all of a sudden they're like, I'm not a creative and I'm not artistic. And so therefore I cannot do this, but you can. So how do you help them?
Yeah. So I think the first thing I help people understand is it is a big part of it is a mindset issue where they misunderstand or they overcomplicate what graphic design really means. And so, for example, one of the things I tell people is, you know, there's different types of graphic design. You have illustrative graphic design, you have 3D animation. I don't do that. If you gave me a pen and paper and had me draw something, I can't draw to save my life. And I'm not trying to create custom illustrations. I'm not trying to create 3D graphics. And so what I realized is that the type of graphic design that most of us in this industry are trying to accomplish is what I call compositional graphic design, where you're taking existing graphics, existing images, and you're pairing it with really good fonts and colors and bringing it together in a clean layout. And the realization I had about that is there's this quote, and I can't remember who it is. It's this famous graphic designer, and he says that graphic design is really just, excuse my language, I'm quoting here, graphic design is moving shit on the screen until it looks good. And that's really what it is. You're just moving things around until you go, hey, that looks good. And so first, it's that mindset shift, is that it's not about being artistic. It's about being creative and moving things around on the screen, those simple elements of shapes and colors and existing graphics. And then the other thing that I try to help people understand, and they don't realize this at first, I think it's a subconscious thing, is that somewhere along the lines between our early childhood and into adulthood, and there's a great TED talk on this by Sir Ken Robinson about how we literally get taught out of our creativity as we get older. And, you know, we're really creative as kids, but somewhere along the lines, we get taught out of our creativity. And being creative with your work requires you to take risk. And risk and failure in corporate America or corporate wherever you happen to live is stigmatized. And so people want to stay within their safe zone and just put bullet points on a screen because nobody's expecting, you know, anything more than that. And that's safe. And so it's about getting outside that comfort zone. And I know that seems like really woo-woo, but it really is that those are the barriers that are preventing people from taking those risks, I think.
Yeah. And if you've joined an organization and you're new to the training team or whatever, and all they've done before are bullet points on screens, et cetera. How do you even break that mold? Because you've got to, you know, there's social pressure involved too with, oh, this is what we've always done. It must work. I'm just going to do it.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. So the way I can answer that question, the way you break that mold is you practice that graphic design, that visual design aspect on projects that have nothing to do with work, with that you don't have skin in the game and there's nothing on the line and you're not worried about your stakeholders and your boss saying, I don't like that. So that's how I learned to become a good graphic designer is practicing on on things that, you know, there was no risk involved.
Yeah. Nick has a really good question in the questions. Yeah. He says, hi, Tim, where do you find pieces of inspiration which can be included in your e-learning design?
Everywhere. Yeah. You just have to really pay attention. So I'll tell you a great story of one way I found inspiration. If, you know, anytime you're out and about in a hotel at an airport, which I know most of us haven't been, but there was one year, I think I was flying to or flying back home from a conference, and I was checking in or out of this hotel, I can't remember. And I was waiting, and, you know, I looked across the lobby, and there was this like kiosk where you could, I don't know, sign up for some rewards program or something stupid. And they had all of these like cool animations. I think it was like a screensaver for their thing. And it had like motion graphics and text. And so I stood there for like 5 minutes and I recorded it with my phone. I've gotten inspiration from the way I was at a Columbia store years ago. And I liked the way they had these banners displayed above their register. I took a picture of it. I get inspiration from like apps that I use on my phone. You know, there's educational apps like Duolingo and all of those where it's like, you know, there's really cool interactions. I get inspiration from that. Pinterest, you know, there's a whole section on user interface design. I get interest from that or inspiration from that. So it's, you know, finding the inspiration isn't hard. It's everywhere. You just have to pay attention to it and go, how can I translate that? Yeah.
Yeah. It's that intentionality. It's when you see it. And a lot of times this is the funny part. Well, I don't know how funny it is, but it's really, really good design. It becomes really transparent. And so you don't really recognize it. You recognize it and it draws your eye, but you don't all of a sudden think to yourself, wow, that's really great design, because that it's just, it did its job. It translated the message and then like how it did it. So unless you're really paying attention and focusing on looking for the things that make it good, that made you feel good and thinking about it. And I love the idea of taking a picture, and you know, heck, we've all got these cameras in our pockets 24/7. Why not take pictures of things that inspire us?
I once heard a story about Steven Spielberg, and when he's like evaluating the quality of a movie and how well a director did, he actually watches the movie on mute so he can pay attention to the technique that was used in filming that movie. And so what you have to do, to your point, I think it, because good design becomes, it marries with the content and it becomes transparent, is you have to look at it and ignore what it's saying and look at the technique that's being used to present that content. That's what I try to do. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Being conscious in the moment. If you just said, oh, that looks cool, then take that extra step and either think about it or capture it to think about it later, and being, you know, aware of that. Oh, I had that reaction. Why did I have that reaction?
Yeah.
Let's see what we can.
And I should say, by the way, I'm not trying to make any sort of connection that, you know, I'm anything like Steven Spielberg. I was just using that as an example. So to make my point.
hey, look, we have to get our inspiration and our models from everywhere.
Yeah.
Even if they're middling talents, they might have something, you know, to share.
He might have a thing to offer too.
Yeah. Absolutely.
So let's do some tips. Like, what are some really good? So let's drive it down a little bit, maybe get a couple tactical tips dropped in here a little bit and help some folks with something a little bit more specific. And I don't even have one off the top of my head, but I'm hoping you do.
Yeah. You know, well, you know, let's start broad, and then we can get more specific into different aspects of visual design. You know, one of the things that I do, I think the easiest thing you can do to start thinking visually about your content, and I do this every time I'm working with a new client on a course, is as I'm storyboarding my content, I pull out sticky notes and I start sketching what I'm going to put on the screen. And my sticky notes don't look pretty. I'm never going to show them to anybody, but it gives me at least a sense first to go, here's what I'm going to put on the screen. And it gives me a framework to figure out how I'm going to represent some of that content. And then as I get into more of the nitty gritty of actually designing my slides or the way the screen's going to look, one of the things I'm a big proponent of during the development process is creating what I call a visual prototype, which is essentially the development of your template. And so I'll put together, you know, whether it's in PowerPoint or Adobe XD or whatever design tool you might be using outside of the authoring tool, you know, put together some sample slides. And one of the things I'm also a big fan of, and this goes back to the question about inspiration, is one of the things I think people need to realize is there's nothing original about graphic design. And so it's okay to look at other people's work and go, ooh, I like the way they use drop shadows there, or I like the way they laid out a character on that screen. You're not ripping them off. You're just pulling in techniques that they used into your design. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, a carpenter doesn't look at a piece of furniture and say, ooh, I like what they did with the dovetail joints there, but that would be ripping it off. No, it's a continuum. It's part of... it's all of the whole industry needs to absorb those improvements and bring them forward, or those changes. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. One thing I do too, because I often wonder if my design aesthetic is the same as everybody else's. And so I have a tendency to pay particular attention to others when I hear them say something like, ooh, that's really nice. Or, ooh, I really like that design. Or, ooh, I really like how they did that. That's when my radar kind of goes off and I start thinking, oh, I need to remember that, that is what other people like. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that would make for a good design aesthetic. Because, you know, sometimes I'll look at something really abstract and go, wow, that's really cool, but I'm not going to turn it into e-learning.
Right. Yeah, exactly. And, you know, our industry, the graphic design industry, no different than our industry, goes through trends. And, you know, we in our industry, we love to create buzzwords, whether it was like, you know, 1 year was m-learning, and then it was gamification and, you know, micro-learning. And now, you know, one of the trends I actually think is important and isn't going away is like accessibility. But same thing with graphic design is, you know, design trends come and go. You know, it used to be skeuomorphism, and then we had flat design, and now we're having neumorphism. And, you know, I think part
I've
of
being...
I've
never heard that one.
Oh, neumorphism? It's this weird, it's this weird marrying between skeuomorphism and flat design. So you're starting to see more of that.
I liked skeuomorphism. I don't know why it went
really?
Away. I know everybody hated it and barely bashed it, and I was like, I think it's kind of cool.
I think with skeuomorphism, part of it was just the uncanny valley, right? When you opened the book app on your iPad, it you knew it was a bookshelf, but that fake wood paneling, that just looked too much like it belonged on the side of a station wagon from our childhood or something, you know?
And for those of you who aren't familiar with skeuomorphism or the history behind it, it's actually really genius what Apple did. So Apple was really kind of the where skeuomorphism came from. And what they realized, and this is a great example where design has intention. It wasn't just because it looked cool, but they realized they needed to teach people how to interact with this new digital interface. So the best way was to make it look familiar. So like when the notepad app looked like a notepad, that's what skeuomorphism is. I think I'm not a big fan of skeuomorphism, but the reason behind it, I find it is genius. So
yeah, it was the visual design, but it was also a metaphor so you could transfer from one way of thinking into a new way of thinking. And then when it was no longer really needed, move on to other designs.
Well, if you think about it, that's a good instructional design strategy too, right? Because we're always trying to map to people's prior knowledge, right? Mm-hmm. And help them bridge that gap. So they have a whole bunch of knowledge. We're trying to give them new knowledge. And our goal is to figure out what they have and what's the best way to help them make that leap to that new knowledge. And so, you know, we can actually use that. I mean, we don't have to go as deep as doing skeuomorphism, but the concepts of why it was done is very good.
Yeah. Yeah. There is you mentioned accessibility and the critical importance of that. And we do have a question in the panel about, just where there, because what are your, favorite tools or techniques for ensuring visual designs are accessible to those who are differently abled than most people? Are there some things that you're always, keeping top of mind as part of that process?
Yeah, I'll preface this by saying accessibility and designing for accessibility is one of my blind spots that I'm working on. So usually what I try to do is if I'm creating something that I know needs to be accessible for a particular audience or somebody with a particular ability limitation, I design something, and then if I have access to that person, I give it to them and I say, what does or does not work about this? And you'd be amazed at all the little things when you're trying to create something for accessibility that you forget about when you can see the screen or hear the audio or use a mouse cursor, right? So, you know, there's different tools out there like screen readers that you can install and see how the tab order works or whether you're using alt text appropriately, or, you know, designing for the proper color contrast. I mean, there's a lot of resources and tools out there. And so the best thing-
I'm sorry to interrupt, but I just want to make sure we get to the point of people finding those tools, right?
Yeah.
I think what's the easiest, if somebody just Googled like accessibility tools for testing my e-learning, would they find them or?
That's a good question. I mean, yeah, ATD is doing a lot of articles on that. I can't think of one off the top of my head where you could find all those tools. I mean, the 508 compliance standards specifically here in the US are primarily written for web design, but there are more and more people out there creating content specifically for accessibility. One of the names that comes off my head, a former colleague of mine, Diane Elkins, she does a lot of work in accessibility and talks about it. It's one of those things that I don't want to call it emerging within our industry because the need for accessibility has been around forever, but more and more authoring tools are supporting accessibility and more people are creating content and resources to help folks learn about accessibility. And so it's one of those things that's still kind of getting up and running in terms of resources.
I tossed a couple of links in there. We do have a couple of blog posts on accessibility resources, et cetera. You know, I've almost got 20 years experience. And initially, in the first half of my career, the only time accessibility came up when we were talking to people about our authoring tool was if it was a government agency and they were mandated to it. But, you know, since that time, it's becoming so much more common for it to be brought up in a discussion initially for, you know, private organizations, et cetera. Finally, you know, folks are recognizing the critical need for it and the importance of it. And it's sad it's taken this long, but yeah, it's going beyond simply mandated.
And I think it's important to realize that accessibility, designing for accessibility, isn't just for people who might have some sort of impairment or handicap. Mm-hmm. I mean, I once worked at an organization where we were creating courses with audio narration, and it wasn't until like 6 months in did somebody tell us that our learners, the speakers on their computers didn't work. And so, you know, none of those people had hearing impairments, but their computer had, you know, audio impairments. Mm-hmm. And so we had to design for that. And so it's not just about, you know, catering to a small population of people who need those, you know, those enhancements. It's really for anybody. So,
yep. And I think the population also expands a little bit when you start to think about, I think when we think about accessibility, we often think about, okay, somebody that's completely blind or somebody that's completely deaf or whatnot. But really, accessibility is for people who, everybody across that spectrum, right? Like you can be just kind of partially blind, right? Mm-hmm. Or just have really kind of bad eyesight. We should probably be designing for people like that as well, right? Or color blindness. Yep. I'm partially colorblind, so you know, different colors don't show up the same way for me, you know, all that kind of stuff. So there's a lot more to accessibility than just thinking, oh, if somebody was totally blind, how would they see this? Or if they were totally deaf, how could we design it?
Yep.
I think it's something that people miss.
Yeah, and I totally agree.
I mean, it changes for us all over time. I've reached the age where I really do appreciate a larger font these days.
I always pump up that setting on my iPhone.
Exactly.
Now, when I get my new iPhone, I don't stick with the default. I always knock it up a notch. Oh yes, much.
I'm looking forward to that. Not really.
It's inevitable.
Yeah, I assume. Yeah, well, you know, there's sometimes where I watch movies and, you know, a certain accent I struggle to understand. And so I'll turn on the captioning just to make sure I, you know, follow the story. So, you know.
Well, my daughter does that. And I remember thinking, why would you do that? She's got perfect hearing. And she's like, no, it's I think it's a generational thing. They turn it on for everything. And what they're watching, they just like to have the closed captions on the TV. And now I even noticed the other night, the closed captions will like kind of follow the person speaking. So it's not just along the bottom. You know, if the person that's doing the talking is like up in the right-hand corner of the screen, kind of off in the distance, the closed caption will pop up above them over there.
I haven't seen that.
So so it kind of maps. It's probably only on certain films and whatnot, but
Yeah.
Yeah, that popped up. But anyways, yeah, back to this stuff. So another tips and tricks. What else you got for us? What else could people be aware of?
It's not related to accessibility, but it's another important thing that we've been giving, rightly so, more effort in our industry is the importance of diversity in terms of the images we use. One of the things that I've noticed in the last several years is that, you know, if you were to go back 10 years ago to find stock images, you would just find like a bunch of white people with really bad stock images of young white people shaking hands. And it was really hard to find diversity in images. And I think one of the interesting things that I've noticed is that more and more organizations and individuals are recognizing that diversity in terms of the images and the graphics we use means more than just racial diversity. You have to consider not just racial diversity, but diversity in terms of the ages of folks that you use, capability, having images of different people with different abilities. That I think is incredibly important when we're designing our content, is to make sure that the images we use represent our audience in a positive way so that people can see themselves in it. I remember, when I used to work at GoDaddy, when I first joined, we had this really awesome library of all of these these illustrated characters that we could use. And they all had the same skin tone of this weird, slightly green color. And one of the things we'd constantly get feedback on is that the lack of diversity, or not the lack of diversity, but the lack of representing real diversity, because nobody's really a green shade, it's still problematic not to have diversity. I don't know if that the point I'm trying to make there makes sense, but one of the things that we pushed really hard on was with our marketing department, who owned the creation of those, was to create characters that represented real skin tones. And they even went further than that. I was really impressed. They included not only real skin tones, but they showed images of women who are, they created characters of women who are pregnant, people wearing, cultural or religious headdresses, all sorts of different things that weren't available to us. I guess the point I'm trying to make there is that even if it's not available to you, you have to push for it because it's the right thing to be doing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Something that just occurred to me too is so many of us we might be the only person on our learning and development team, but we're not soloists in that we're not the owners of the content. And we get given content, and it's already a PowerPoint deck with the bullet points, etc. What are some of the ways you've got, tips, et cetera, for actually working and getting those folks to transform from thinking about the words that capture the information to, the visual presentation? Because some people might say, well, they need all this information, which is a constant problem we've got with, mm-hmm. In terms of working with SMEs, et cetera, and then getting everything rounded out.
Two things I'll say about that. So, when a SME hands you, their PowerPoint that they've worked hours on and created all those bullet points, like I smile and nod and go, oh, this is great, and I put it aside and I treat that as raw content. And yes, sometimes your stakeholders want you to just, import that into PowerPoint and add a next button, or import those PowerPoints into your authoring tool and add an next button. And that's the worst thing you can be doing. So don't just take that content and transform it into an e-learning course. And then the other thing that I think is important is don't assume that you have to rely on your stakeholders or your subject matter experts to tell you how to transform that content. It's so easy for us to get in the mindset that we're deferential to our stakeholders and our subject matter experts, and we're not. You have to work in partnership and in tandem and take that content and figure out how you're going to transform it into learning. Because what they're providing you in those PowerPoints is not learning content. And so it's treating it as the raw content it is and working to transform it. Yeah.
It's very typical. The whole, the stock image, world is really popular. We get questions a lot, and I think we do have a few libraries too of our own that we share with folks for how to find stock photos and how to use the right ones. I think we've even had some episodes on here of, like with Kevin Thorne and whatnot, how to take a stock image or stock illustration and modify it to your needs so you can change it. it's really popular. Everybody should really get into at least figuring out how to make some modifications, because to the accessibility point, you know, you can take one image and make it a bunch of different colors.
Absolutely. Whatever. And, you know, in the stock, the great thing about stock images is that there are more every day. There's a new website that pops up where you can get free stock images. And the quality of those stock images is just getting better and better, where they look like real people doing real things in real working environments, not those, you know, like I said earlier, a bunch of white people shaking hands and staring at the camera, you know, from 1998. And so the last thing I'll say, another tip that I'll say, going, you mentioned Kevin's comment about, you know, modifying those images. So I guess before we wrap up here soon, I guess at the top of the hour, the one thing I wanted to mention was, I think one of the big barriers I think people have to creating good visuals or good design is that you have to use expensive or complicated tools like PowerPoint or Illustrator. And the reality is that, you know, the tool you know how to use is the best graphic design tool for you. So whether you're using just PowerPoint, you know, that I use PowerPoint all the time to do simple graphic design tasks.
If you're on a Mac, the Mac side of the house, Keynote is a fantastic design tool for creating images and videos and know, lots of different things. So some of the tools that you get for free really are the best. That's for sure.
Yeah. I use PowerPoint, all the time. Like I'll use animations in PowerPoint and the morph transition, and then I'll export it as a video, and then I'll sync it together in Camtasia and create a little simple motion animation using animations in PowerPoint. So yeah, the options are endless. You don't have to use expensive or complicated tools to create good graphics or good design or good animations.
For sure. For sure. What's your favorite? Before we start to wrap up here, sure. I don't know if we forgot to tell you, but we kind of like to end at about quarter till the hour. But that's okay. No big deal. What is, like, do you have any stories of like the most interesting example, or that something that your project that you did where you took something else in its one state and you were able to redesign it in a really successful way?
Yeah. So when I was still working at Kohl's department stores in their learning department, we had to create training on the inventory process. And there was this one specific procedure where store employees had to tape these inventory tags in a particular order throughout each department. And you've probably seen, if you've ever been to a store, there's these little white tags that get placed on every single fixture. Some say inventory, some say do not inventory. And they have to get placed in this really meticulous order. They have to be in order for all these tracking purposes. And the procedure, which was originally written as like a job aid, was very simple. It was like each inventory tag should be placed in numerical order, snaking through the department, front to back, left to right. Simple, like it was three steps. But what we found is that our employees struggled following those steps. They couldn't conceptualize those three bullet points into what they actually needed to do. So what we did was we created a simple course where they could, where we created a simple animation where we took we had a 3D image of the department, and we literally illustrated it for them, where we animated those tags going in the store. And what was cool about that was, A, not only did it help visualize and help our learners see what we were trying to say, but what we were able to do with that was then pivot and turn it into an interaction where they could like drag and drop and practice doing it in a bunch of different contexts and different departments. And it was just that simple switch of how we represented that content that allowed people to be prepared to do that task on the job. And that just made all the difference. And it was, you know, it was just a simple course. So,
A good example where it seems like what's being provided isn't complex. It's not complicated. It's should be straightforward, and yet lots of room for error, but shifting it into a more visual mode makes it clearer and makes it, you know, leads to behavior change and all those things that, that we want to do in our biz.
Yeah. And it's just about, you know, like I said earlier, I made this statement before and I'll say it again, you know, a lot of times people think design, the visual design is about making things look pretty, and it's really not. It's about helping your learners see what you're trying to say.
Yep. Seeing and not reading.
Yeah. Seeing what you're trying to say. I love that. What a great way to wrap up today's show, Tim. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you for having me. Yeah.
We've probably got a whole bunch of stuff to talk about. What's coming up, Chris?
What do we have on next week? I've forgotten already.
Well, we've got something awesome. That's all I know.
Yeah, right on. Well, let's throw in the LinkedIn group for Idiotic. Make sure folks are connecting with us in there. And Tim, while we're doing that, throw your own contact details in. People want to follow up. Awesome. I was going to say, I know we had the book in earlier, but make sure the book is in there too for folks to find that. So
for sure.
Awesome. Yeah. If you're just new to Idiotic, joining us in the audience for the first time, in the chat, whatever, check us out in the LinkedIn group. Lots of stuff gets posted there. And of course, before you leave today, sign up for next week's episode.
We'll
see you all again next week.
It's awesome.
And in the meantime, everybody dance on out of here, guys. See you all next week.
And don't forget to buy Tim's book.
Buy the book.